Chapter 17. The point of transition between late winter and early spring is barely perceptible, and one must rely on small clues in order to be informed that that point has indeed been crossed. Scattered around in a tired sweep of a dull landscape, a mere suggestion of winter remains in the snowdrops, but these have already begun to relinquish their place in the margins, to burst a bright yellow from welcome primroses. Elsewhere, catkins dangle from the hazel, and as the fresh spears of daffodils thrust their way through the thin green veneer, one starts to feel that the earth underfoot is beginning to stir. It is mid-March, and up on the hill, Torn has already begun to put his sheep to pasture. Meanwhile, the vines are cut back and the fruit trees pruned. What traces of winter that still linger are no longer a deterrent, and one feels quite sure that spring means to start working in earnest. I keep my eyes open to notice any activity in the valley, in Bazga or Kluchi. When I see a neighbour start ploughing their field, we call on Torna to come down and do ours. When seeds are sown, we follow suit. This is tried and tested local knowledge, and we copy their example. The sun comes up on a bright spring morning, and the blossom on the cherry is the first to appear. As the day breaks open, the air is tinged with the sound of tractor engines rumbling in the valley. Having already ploughed most of the small plots, Torna comes down from the top of the hill, and with a harrow in tow starts breaking the clods on the topsoil and making a fine tilth, ready for things to grow. Sunk between each undulation, small irregular plots are eked out. Now, these are called dragas. Torna is a friend to everyone, and after harrowing our new field, he moves on to that of a neighbour we christened the Salad Woman, on account of the fact that her walk home from her field passed through our land, and she would often leave us a sample of her produce at the foot of the barn for us to find. With the ploughing done, the Salad Woman thanks Torn in the customary manner, with a glass of homemade plum brandy. The process of making homemade brandy occupies many of the villagers as the year heads towards the autumn equinox and the days further contract. Then there is a stirring in the orchard. This is the time when thoughts turn to that ancient art of alchemy, that is a particular phenomenon in the village. The dark art of distilling deep purple fruits is one of the greatest of all village mysteries. It is the transformation of water into fire. After 5 fairly dormant years, the plum trees in our orchard burst into life again. We watched as branches became laden with fruit, and it soon became clear that we would need advice from a village elder. Fortunately, Torna was hand to offer guidance as to the most efficacious method of removing fruit from the tree. With a long pole in hand, he thrashes at the branches, knocking the fruit, along with leaves and twigs, down onto a stretched-out tarpaulin. It looked a somewhat brutal method, but it did the job. In no time we had loaded up his tractor with 2 barrels filled with plums, which then went up the hill to his courtyard to be milled. We were not alone in having a good harvest this year. Across the whole village there was fervent activity. Many trees had been particularly fruitful. The reduced pulp after milling was returned to the barrel and left for 3 weeks for the magic to start working. Finally, after 22 days, the lid was lifted from our barrels of plums. Torna took the lid of the barrel and skimmed off the top layer of pulp, and after a thorough stirring, the true colour of the fruit was revealed. A cauldron was then filled, holding about 30 to 35 litres of liquid. From here, a fire was lit underneath it, and the mixture heated up. The resulting steam then passed through a pipe attached to the top of the cauldron, from where it bent at 90 degrees, and then again until it dips into a second barrel of cold water, around which the pipe coils to an outlet at the bottom. As the steam travels through the coil, becoming condensation, cooled by the water in the second barrel, a trickle of brandy emerges at the far end. The first few drops of brandy are by far the strongest, and as the process continues, it becomes progressively diluted. Regular measurements are taken until the entire mix has achieved an alcohol level of around 44%. At that point, the cauldron is emptied, and the whole procedure is started again. From these two barrels, we managed to distill 12 litres of pure plum brandy. And while the best brandy is made from plums, in years when there is a dearth of these fruits, others are substituted. Quince is said to make excellent brandy, but one time only aged pears from the Napoleon pear tree were available to us. I wouldn't recommend them. The offering of a glass of homemade brandy by the salad woman, after Torn had finished harrowing his field, is just one of the small rituals that are part of the remnants of a community. From there he moves on to the field belonging to the third sister, and following that, a succession of others. In these fields a narrow selection of produce will be grown, sweet corn, potatoes and marrow, much of which will be fodder for the animals. Following this, Torna turns his attention to a small clearing in the heart of his wood, and the plough here makes deep drills for sowing potatoes. Following behind, Maritza and Mima lay the potatoes in the trenches and cover them up. Below this, the lower undulation is being made ready for corn. It is a demanding job, and sometimes the good earth disgorges huge stones in the wake of the plough, stones that could quite easily break the ploughshare. By late afternoon back in the valley, others are responding to the warming soil. Our new neighbours plant onions and carrots, while a little way off on a strip of land behind Bara's house, Bieber covers the seeds on the staple of the family table. In our new field, raised beds have been constructed, and likewise our hopes have been raised that this year will be a fruitful one. A stone's throw away at the home of the Italians, Barbara too is making ready her small family plot. In our garden the last seedings have been sown, but already some of the earlier plantings have begun to appear. And below our house in the valley, the third sister is making the most of the day's sunshine. Sweet corn is one of the last seeds to be planted, and often just before the first anticipated downpour arrives. And while Mika's wife Angelka finds his field moist and crumbly, in Torna's field the land is hard and parched, and the seed drill struggles to cover the vulnerable kernels. But the job is done, and all that remains is to wait for the rain to bring nourishment and refreshment to the seed and soil alike.